All right, please stand as we sing our first song, Beautiful One, this morning.
Wonderful, so wonderful is your unfailing love. Your cross has spoken mercy over me. No eye has seen, no ear has heard, no heart could fully know how glorious, how beautiful you are. Beautiful one I love, beautiful one I adore, beautiful one my soul must sing. Powerful, so powerful, your glory fills the skies. Your mighty works display for all to see the beauty of your majesty. Awakes my heart to sing how marvelous, how wonderful you are. Beautiful one I love, beautiful one I adore, beautiful one my soul must sing. Beautiful one I love, beautiful one I adore, beautiful one my soul must sing. You open my eyes, see your wonders anew. You capture my heart with this love. 'Cause nothing on earth is as beautiful as you. You open my eyes, see your wonders anew. You capture my heart with this love. 'Cause nothing on earth is as beautiful as you. Beautiful one I love, beautiful one I adore, beautiful one my soul must sing.
Please welcome each other to Cooper Baptist Church this morning, especially if somebody you haven't seen in a while. As you're making your way back, we're going to sing a couple more choruses of that one. And just join us in singing and make your way back. Here we go.
Beautiful one I love, beautiful one I adore, beautiful one my soul must sing. Beautiful one I love, beautiful one sing. Somewhere
Right before we sing that last verse, if you're an usher taking up the offering this morning, please come as we sing this last verse.
Just a few more weary days in heaven. Fly away, fly away to a land where joy shall never end. Fly away.
Sound beautiful this morning. This morning we have a special guest that's going to come and speak. I know many of you have been praying, and it's been a long time. How long has it been since you've been to the back here? Into about 11 months. Miss Catherine Jean has been gone, and she would like to share a little bit with you today, and so we're going to provide her with this opportunity at this time.
Hi, if I haven't gotten a chance to meet you yet, my name is Catherine Jean. I'm Kenny and Ivy's granddaughter. I'm sure you've heard something about me this year. I've been traveling abroad this year with missions. I was with an organization called The World Race, where I traveled for 11 months. I just got back a couple weeks ago back into the States. Wasn't expecting to share much this morning, but I just wanted to say thank you guys so much. I know that there's people in this room that financially supported me, and people that have been praying for me this year, and people that have been hugging my Nana and Pops when they've been sad. So I just wanted to say thank y'all. This past May, not this year, but the year before, I graduated from college and had planned on going to chiropractic school. And the Lord was just tugging on my heart to take a year off. And I looked into some programs and thought about maybe doing a year of missions as a gap year before I went on to go to chiropractic school. And the Lord opened the doors for me to travel with this organization. I spent 4 months in Central America where we would haul wood days on end to build a church in Honduras. We did house visits in Guatemala, Costa Rica. I did a lot of farming, learned how to make some fertilizer, got to pray over some really incredible people. And in Nicaragua, I got to live at a women's home for women who'd been rescued out of prostitution. Sat with them, loved on them and their babies. These women had been put into these brothels when they were 6 years old by their parents, and just seen a lot of people healed the way that the Lord is working all across the globe. After my time in Central America, I went on to Eastern Europe. I spent about 2 months in Albania, which is when Christmas time was happening. Got to go caroling, pray over families in the streets, did a lot of evangelism, and did some college coffee ministry, so met up with college girls and just shared my testimony with them, prayed over them, championed them where they were at in life. And then we moved on to Romania, which is kind of when the war started between Ukraine and Russia, and we accepted Ukrainian refugees. And during that time was really, really hard, but such a gift from the Lord to be able to sit with mamas and their babies as they were mourning the loss of their home, mourning the loss of leaving their husbands and their fathers behind to fight in the war that it wasn't really expected for them. And got to do some youth ministry as well. And most recently, I just got back from Africa. I spent about three-ish months there where we did kids ministries, we prayed over people in their communities, and I also, this past month, worked in Swaziland at what's called Care Points, and I would teach English to preschool kids in the morning. I had four-year-olds, and then we would feed them lunch, and it's so crazy because we were feeding them the fortified rice packets. I don't know if y'all have ever made those, maybe in your schools or in the community. Feeding fortified rice packets that came from the States and from Arkansas, which is where my family lives at. And so just a blessing from the Lord this year, just the way that he is moving in all areas, just seen a lot of incredible things and had a lot of opportunities just to see his love across the globe this year. I know I'm going to get to come back and speak to the youth another week, but I just wanted to say thank you guys so much. This church is incredible. Thanks for loving my family and for praying for me this year.
Thank you, Miss Catherine, for sharing all of that. We surely are thankful for people like you that have a heart for ministry. Please stand as we continue to sing this morning.
I want to be close, close to your side, so heaven is real and death is alive. I want to hear voices of angels above, singing as one, hallelujah, holy, holy, God Almighty, great I am, who is worthy. God Almighty, the great I am. I want to be near to your heart, loving the world and hating the dark. I want to see tribals living again, singing as one, hallelujah, holy, holy, God Almighty, great I am, who is worthy, none beside me, God Almighty, the great I am. mountains shake before you. The demons run and flee. At the mention of your name, King of Majesty, there is a power in hell, or any who can stand before the power and the presence of the great I am.
We're going to turn things over to Brother Rob. You may be seated at this time. We have some testimonies to hear from the youth that have been at camp, and I'm going to just turn things over to him. Thank you so much.
I think we had three or four teens that we took 18 teens to camp. I think three or four teens wanted to come up and just share a 1 or 2 minute testimony. So if you want to make your way up here now, those teens. Thanks to Miss Catherine. That was an encouragement for sure. I've always said that I can't prove this other than just experience. You can grow more in a week on a mission trip than you really can in a year going through your kind of normal routines of life. And so I can only imagine the growth that's taking place in your life over the better part of a year. And you'll just mom, dad, she'll never be the same again in a good way. And so that's a act of faith and a step of faith. So thank you for that, Miss Catherine. We'll look forward to hearing more. We just have two. Let me see the microphone. We had a good time at camp. Like I said, we took 18 teens, and here are a couple of them. Several are here this morning. Here are a couple of them just kind of share some of the highlights from the week. And then we also have Brother Roland that put together a nice overview of in photo set to music. And so I appreciate we've thrown a lot of curves at Brother Roland this weekend, even here in this service. So thank you for being a help to the teens in that. But first, the testimonies.
Good morning.
Morning.
This thing doesn't sound like it's
up. It's on.
There it is. my favorite part of camp, what I found out, and I just realized this morning, was they had this thing that you could go do during your free time, and it was called the rock wall. You can get to climb up it. There's different levels. And this morning I realized from all the amazing preaching I heard every night, every morning, breakfast time, lunch, dinner, every night this whole week during church camp, I realized how lately my life has been like this rock wall that I'd go to during my free time and climb. Level one, I'd do that. Level three, I'd skip to level three, accomplish that. I got to level four, and I started to struggle. And it took a lot of time and strength to get through. Then there's level five. Level five, I could not do. I would get halfway and I'd fall. I did that like three times, and I kept falling every time I'd get halfway. And eventually, I worked up the courage to ask for help, because there's one kid who he just go right up it and just fine. And I was like, man, I wish I could do that. And I asked for help, and I got halfway. He stood there. He went up on the other side and helped me, talked me through it. And now that I just realized this morning, it's kind of how God is. He'll stand there right beside us, talk to us, walk us through it. And during this week, we did memory verses. We had red team versus blue team, and whoever got read the most verses and memorized them day by day, we got more points. And I've realized the power of God and His Word, and how His Word comforts us. It will guide us and get us through whatever struggle we're going through. He will meet us halfway where we are. And that's what I realized about this connecting the rock wall thing this morning, just how my life's been lately. And I'm so glad I went to church camp, and I thank Brother Rob and Miss Michelle for taking us and just being good mentors for us. And that's just all I have to say about church camp. And thank you for the ones who paid for it and encouraged us to go. Thank you.
First off, I would like to thank all of you for donating and allowing us to go back again, because without you guys, would not have happened. And for that, you guys owe yourselves a round of applause. Secondly, I would like to thank my youth group and my sponsors for putting up with me. I know I'm a handful, but thank you. And thirdly, I would like to thank the Lord Himself for just allowing my heart to be open to the sermons, to all the friendships, and all the people around me. One thing that I really liked is I'm becoming a frequent flyer there. I've been there for the past two summers and two winters. So a lot of people know my name. I know a lot of people there. And just going back to that same friendships, and like, it's almost like we never left. You know, all we have to do is just catch up with each other, and we're back at it. You know, we have that same bond. And I had a lot of new friendships this year, but most importantly, you know, the blue team won. Sorry, Bryson. Oh, wait, sorry, Kylie. But, you know, it was just a blessing to be back there. And, you know, a lot of people knew my name, even though I may not know theirs, but there's this one thing that stuck with me. There's this kid. I'm not going to say his name, but we're just going to call him Random Kid. So this random kid walks up to me, and, you know, I've known him. I've known him last summer. I know him from the winter before. And, you know, he's a good kid. He's really funny. But the question he asked me, how do I know when I've done all I can do for the Lord and I'm truly saved? And, you know, I told him, I said, well, the only... Okay. Is this better? Okay. Sorry. Person, there's only two people that can really tell if you are truly saved, and that is you and him. And then the other thing I said is that in order to do everything for him, whenever you do something and you feel like there's no restraint, like going to church, reading your Bible, and there's no restraint, there's no like, one, oh, maybe I should do this instead. That's how you truly know you've fully done all you can do. When there's no way, there's no, you know, hasting to yourself to where you can't and you don't want to read the Bible. And just thinking to myself, I was like, dang, I just said something. I'm such a hypocrite. I just said something, and I truly have not been doing it myself. For those of you who know me, I can play baseball and football for hours, and I get tired of playing, you know, just doing what I love, but I can't sit here and read my Bible for 5 minutes. And so one thing the Lord really worked on me is I need to start reading more of my Bible and giving more of my time to Him instead of video games, sports, and stuff like that. And once again, I just want to thank all of you and Brother Rob and Miss Michelle all my youth for putting up with me. But most importantly, I just want to thank him. Thank you.
Thanks, fellas. For those that many of you all haven't been there, it is a different camp. Before we came here, the teens went to other camps, and that's fine. But Southland is different. It really is. It's very grounded on the Word of God. There's three chapel services a day, and there's God and I time, and there's cabin devotions. I mean, literally, this much of the day is spent in the Word of God. And by chapel, I don't mean just little sermonettes. I mean services that are an hour and a half to 2 hours long, and a lot of that's preaching. So they really got ground in the Word of God, and that's what they're centered around, which is good. And so thankful for that. And thank you for those testimonies, fellas. Again, lots of other good testimonies. And thank you all for supporting. We do have a slideshow that Brother Roland put together, a slideshow. We want to show that. And then Logan, I think you have the, if you could come up after the slideshow and read the verse. So just come on up here and get ready to read Jeremiah 33. But I hope this slideshow will be an encouragement to you.
If my heart could tell a story, if my life would sing a song, if I have a testimony, if I have anything at all, no one ever cared for me like Jesus. His faithful hand has held me all this way. And when I'm old and gray and all my days are numbered on the earth, let it be known, in you alone my joy was found. Oh, my joy, my joy. Let my children tell their children. Let this be their memory. That all my treasure was in heaven. And you were everything to me. No one ever cared for me like Jesus. His faithful hand has held me all this way. And when I'm old and gray and all my days are numbered on the earth, let it be known, in you alone my joy was found. I found my joy. You're still my everything.
While Logan comes up, turn to Jeremiah 33. Jeremiah 33, if you're able to stand, I invite you to stand for the reading of God's Word. Jeremiah 33, please, if you're able to stand, verses 1 through 11.
Good morning, again. Please turn with me to Jeremiah 33, verses 1 through 11. Moreover, the word of the Lord came unto Jeremiah the second time while he was yet shut up in the court of the prison, saying, Thus saith the Lord, the maker thereof, the Lord that formed it, to establish it, the Lord is his name. Call unto me, and I will answer thee, and shew thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. For thus saith the Lord, the God of Israel, concerning the houses of this city, and concerning the houses of the kings of Judah, which are thrown down by the mounts and by the sword. They come to the fight with chandeliers, but it is to fill them with the dead bodies of men who I have slain in mine anger and in my fury, and for all whose wickedness I have bid my face from the city. Behold, I will bring it health and cure, and I will cure them, and will reveal unto them the abundance of peace and truth. And I will cause the captivity of Judah as the captivity of Israel to return, and we will build them as it the first. And I will cleanse them from all their iniquity, whereby they have sinned against me, and I have pardoned all their iniquities, whereby they have sinned, and whereby they have transgressed against me. And it shall be to me a name of joy, a praise and an honor before all the nations of the earth, which shall hear all the good that I do unto them, and they shall fear and tremble for all the goodness and for all the prosperity that I procure unto it. Thus saith the Lord, again there shall be heard in this place, which ye shall be desolate without man and without beast, even in the cities of Judah and in the streets of Jerusalem, that are desolate, without man, and without inhabitation, and without beast. The voice of the joy, and the voice of the gladness, the voice of the bridegroom, and the voice of the bride, the voice of them that shall say, Praise the Lord of hosts, for the Lord is good, for his mercy endureth forever, and of them that shall bring the sacrifice of praise unto the house of the Lord, for I will cause the return to the captivity of the island, and as the first, saith the Lord. Dear Lord, we just thank you for this day and thank you for your opportunity, Lord. Lord, we ask that you bless Brother Rob before us and that we just open our hearts to his word and your word, Lord. You know, it's your word that he's saying, and we just hope that everyone here, you know, really soaks into their heart and just hope that Holy Spirit is around here, Lord. And we do it all for you, for your name, I pray. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Thank you. Jeremiah 33 comes on the heels, of course, of chapter 32. In chapter 32, the first few verses, the word of the Lord comes into Jeremiah and tells him to prophesy against King Zedekiah and to prophesy against him. And so he does that. He obeys the word of the Lord, and he's thrown in prison for it, and he's left alone for it. And so Jeremiah 33 begins with the nation is in captivity, the prophet Jeremiah himself is in captivity, And it's a pretty dire situation. And Jeremiah, at least, is in prison for not doing, he's not in there because he did something wrong. He did what God had told him to do. And yet, sometimes just following God, obeying God, lands you in some kind of undesirable place. But even in that place, you do have a prayer. Sometimes we might use the term like, well, so-and-so doesn't even have a prayer that they're going to get out of this. Well, we do have a prayer. In Jeremiah 33, especially verse 3, if we could direct our attention there, it's where we'll spend our time together this morning largely. Call unto me. In fact, let's say it together, Jeremiah 33, 3. Call unto me, and I will answer thee, and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. I just put down a couple of thoughts from this. If you have your bulletin, you should have a sermon outline in there. But the first thing I put down that we see in Jeremiah 33:3 is that I have the privilege to call unto God. God invites us to call unto Him. So I have the privilege to call unto God. And even when there's no place to turn, if you look at verse 1, and I think the fellows have a slide, the slides back there of the sermon. Verse 1 says, moreover, the word of the Lord came unto Jeremiah the second time when he was yet shut up in the court of the prison. So Jeremiah was shut up. He was hemmed in. He was closed in the court of the prison. He had nowhere to go. But I'll just tell you, even when you have no place to go, it's a good time to hear from God, or it's a good time to talk to God. This week at Southland Camp was a good time to get alone with God. The phones were taken away from us. Either the counselors had them or my wife and I had them. And it was just kind of a technology-free environment as far as what the kids, the teens, are normally used to. And you could really hear from God and talk to God in that kind of a shut-in environment. I'm guessing Miss Catherine might share when she comes back, when she has a longer time to spare. I'm guessing when you're in a bordering country that's at war, I'm guessing that's a pretty good time and place and setting to talk to. When you have no place to turn, literally, be a wonderful, wonderful place. So even if you find yourself in some undesirable situation where you're just following the Lord's call in your life, like Miss Catherine did, and here you're in this place where it seems like there's no place to turn, we always do have a place to turn. In fact, keep your place here, but look at Psalm 142. This is a prayer of David when he was hiding out in the cave. King David, when he was hiding out in the cave, listen to the desperation in his voice. Psalm 142, I cried unto the Lord with my voice unto the Lord I did make my supplication. I poured out my complaint before him, I showed him before him my trouble. When my spirit was overwhelmed within me, then thou knewest my path. In the way wherein I have walked, they privily laid a snare for me. Verse 4, I looked on my right hand and beheld, but there was no man who would know me. Refuge failed me. No man cared for my soul. I cried unto thee, O Lord. I said, thou art my refuge and my portion in the land of the living. Attend unto my cry, for I am brought very low. Deliver me from my persecutors, for they are stronger than I. Bring my soul out of prison, that I may praise thy name. The righteous shall compass me about, for thou shalt deal bountifully with me. So if you find yourself in a place where there's nowhere to turn, you have the privilege to call on God, but also when you have no right to ask, when you have no right to ask. Verse 2 of Jeremiah 33 says, thus saith the Lord, the maker thereof, the Lord that formed it, establish it, the Lord is his name. Jeremiah was in prison, and he was petitioning the Lord, the creator of everything in the universe. The Bible says the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. He had no right whatsoever, humanly speaking, to ask. He was a lowly, carbon-based individual speaking to the maker of heavens and earth. And yet God invited him, and God invites you and I to call unto him and to ask. We live in something of an entitlement mindset today, I think. We see it, I know when I coached high school sports, it was It was there. I think teachers might say they see it in the classroom, at least many of them. Employers, I know, would see it in the marketplace, where we just kind of sort of, there's a lot of us that are just kind of an entitlement mindset. We just sort of kind of expect things to go our way. And I just want to say, God is gracious. Other than the gospel of Jesus Christ, I mean, God owes us nothing. And if you have the gospel, and if I have the gospel, we have everything. God doesn't owe us anything. And sometimes we kind of come to God feeling like, well, we're owed this. Jeremiah knew. He was shut up in prison. He knew that the Lord was his master, and servants don't make requests of masters. And those that are indebted don't make requests to their creators. But even when we have no right to ask, God is still listening. Hebrews 4 says this, "For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but was at all points tempted as in we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need." God wants us to come to Him. When we have no place to turn, when we have no right to ask, and when we have no money to pay, when we have no money to pay. Jeremiah was a prophet. If there was a Forbes list of the 100 most richest people in the world back then, which there wasn't, but if there was, Jeremiah as a prophet would not have been on it. He had no money. Plus, he was in prison. So not only did he not have any money, but he wasn't getting any money for being in prison. So it was kind of a double whammy. He was in a hopeless situation. The nation was in turmoil. He couldn't even get himself out of prison. He had no money to pay. And yet God invited him to call unto Him, even in that desperate time. Isaiah 55:1 reminds you and I, we have the same thing. We may not have much of this world's resources, financially or otherwise. We may not have any money to help kind of get us out of a jam, so to speak. But we have the privilege to call on God. Isaiah 55 says this, "Ho, everyone that thirsteth, come ye to the waters. He that hath no money, come ye, buy and eat. Yea, come without price, without money and without price." Also we see in verse 5 that he had no strength to fight. He had no place to turn, no right to ask, no money to pay, no strength to fight. And yet God invited him to call unto Him. Verse 5 says, "They come to fight with the Chaldeans, but it is to fill them with the dead bodies of men who I have slain in mine anger and in my fury, and for all whose wickedness I have hid my face from this city." He had no way to fight. The Israelites had no way to fight, but they had a God to fight for him. And the Bible says that God was going to kill the Chaldeans and that had come against them. And so he was out of resources, but he had no strength left to fight. He was in prison, no doubt nothing left. Isaiah 41:10 says this about you and I not having our strength but relying on God's strength. "Fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God." He says, "I will strengthen thee, yea, I will help thee, yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of mine righteousness." And Isaiah 40, verse 29, a verse many knows well, "He giveth power to the faint, and to them that have no might, he increaseth strength. Even the youth shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall." Say it with me if you know it. "But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint." I'm not going to ask for people to raise their hands, because every hand would be going up. If you ever just sort of been out of gas and had nothing left, I felt that this week at camp. In Sunday school, I think some of our teens felt that way. The eyelids were pretty heavy and the shoulders were kind of drooped. Sometimes you just get to a place where you've got nothing left. You've exerted every last ounce of energy you have. You've cried every last tear that you have. And you've got nothing left in the tank. And even in those times where people may take a step back from you because you've got nothing to offer them, you still have the privilege to call on God. Even in these desperate situations, you still have the privilege to call on God. Secondly, God has promised to take my call. God has promised to take my call. He says in the last part of verse 3, "I will answer thee." He says, I will answer thee. There's an obligation that God has to his family. He doesn't have the obligation. He's not obligated himself to respond to those outside his family, except in the context of a prayer of salvation. But he is obligated to his family. And when his children call out to him, he's promised to take our call. You would never do this, but from time to time, your phone may ring. And in the old days, it was caller ID on the Codaphone or what. How many remember Codaphone and answer machines? And okay, I thought we were older than that. But anyway, that used to be a thing. But now we just look on our phone and we're like, I don't know if I want to take that call right now. You would never do that. Sometimes I do that. But God, if you're calling out to him as his child, he's promised to take that call, even in this desperate situation. I will say this, there's two caveats to his promise to take your call. One of those caveats is, no unrepentant sinners. God is not obliged to hear those that are not in his family. So no unrepentant sinners. 1 Peter 3:12 says this, the eyes of the Lord are over the righteous and his ears are open to their cry. God has promised, there are some things that God is omnipotent and he can do all things, but there are some things that if he did them, it would violate his character. You know, one of those things is, you know, God cannot lie. A God that can do anything, but yet he cannot lie. Why? Because it would violate his character. Another thing that God cannot do, even though he can do everything, is God cannot refuse a sinner that repents. Because the Bible says in John chapter 10, Jesus said, all those that come to me, I will in no wise cast out. So the caveat to God taking your call, your desperate call of prayer, of faith, the caveat are two. One is no unrepentant sinners. And secondly, no unconfessed sin. There's no unconfessed sin. In fact, Isaiah 59:2 says this, but your iniquities, that is your sin, your trespasses, your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you that he will not hear. So God can do anything, and God sees all. The Bible says the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong on behalf of those whose hearts are perfect towards him. He sees all, but the Bible says there are some things he just doesn't hear when there's unconfessed sin. And that's the bad news. The good news is, say it with me if you know it, the good news is 1 John 1:9, say it if you know it. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If you've got unconfessed sin in your life and you're trying to get a hold of God, you can keep going around that bush as long as you want, but nothing is going to change until God in his word is not going to hear us. He's not going to hear me. He's not going to hear you until we get that sin confessed and right. And then he is, so to speak, all ears. His ears will be open to our cry because they're open to the cries of the righteous. So God has promised to take my call if there's no unrepentant, the caveat, no unrepentant sinners and no unconfessed sin. The third thing I would share with you in just the few moments we have left about when God says to call me is God has the power to help me. God has the power to help me. Would you say it together? God has the power to help me. In some going on, well, over 16 years of pastoral ministry, sometimes people have come to me and I've just been completely powerless to, humanly speaking, to be of any help to them. And sometimes maybe people have come to you, just maybe a child comes to a parent and with some great hurt or great need, and there's just, humanly speaking, we don't have the power to help. But God has the power to help. I was reminded this week of just me getting older, and in fact I even told my wife, I mean, I'm just I may be, it's hard for me to admit, but I may just be past the point of being able to go to camp and really take part in the things that I want to take. Because we're not the kind that just kind of goes to camp and sits in our cabin until Saturday comes. We like to be out with the kids. But I'm getting older, and there's things that I don't have the power to do that I used to be able to do. But God still has the power. He's been helping his children since Adam and Eve. He's been helping his children, but he still has the power to help. Look at the last part of verse 3 in Jeremiah 33 says, he says, I will show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. Great and mighty things which thou knowest not. Well, what can he do? First of all, I would say this. He has the power for the recovery of homes. Look at verse 4. The recovery of home. Look at verse 4. For thus saith the Lord God of Israel concerning the houses of this city, concerning the houses of the kings of Judah, which were thrown down by the mounts and by the sword. So houses were torn down. Look at verse 6. He says, behold, talking about the homes, I will bring it health and cure. I will cure them and reveal unto them the abundance of peace and truth. So God has the power for the recovery of homes. In this war-torn setting, homes were just torn down by the sword and by the ravages of war. They were upside down, if you want to speak to that. I think of the subprime market back in the 2008-2009 window, and maybe even some places still today, where just so many people were upside down in their houses, meaning they owed more on the house of what it was worth, and that kind of set off, what was it called, the Great Recession, and so many people lost homes and jobs, and the government had to issue another bailout, those kind of things, because people were upside down in their houses. Can I just say this, spiritually speaking, it's not on the news. You won't find it on Fox or CNN or wherever you turn to for your news. But houses are very much turned upside down today spiritually. Spiritually speaking, houses are, we have strayed so far. Even in our country, which was once a Christian nation, even here in Louisiana, part of the, many would call the Bible Belt, houses are just upside down. They're not in order the way that God has set them in His Word. And we see that time and time again, spiritually upside down. Isaiah 5 says this, verse 20, woe unto them that call evil good and good evil, that put darkness for light and light for darkness. Woe unto them that are wise in their own eyes and prudent in their own strength. We need the wisdom to see our homes as they are. I don't know what's going on that's good and right or off kilter in your home. But I do know that God has the power to recover that. And God wants to recover that. But I think sometimes the Bible says through wisdom is a house built, and by understanding it is established. I think sometimes we've been kind of upside down in our homes and our values and what we put priorities on as parents, what we encourage our kids in the earthly, temporal things instead of the spiritual, eternal things. We've been upside down for so long, we don't even realize it. We need the eyes to see that we need our homes recovered. We need our marriages recovered. We need our kids recovered from the clutches of Satan. And God has the power to do that, and He invites us to call unto Him for the recovery of homes, for redemption and second chances. Verse 7 says, I will cause the captivity of Judah and the captivity of Israel to return and will build them as the first. Redemption and second chances. If you come through the doors this morning, we are thankful you're here, whatever state, whether you're as close to God as you've ever been or where you feel like you're as far away as you ever have been, we're glad you're here this morning. But just know this, if you came through those doors this morning backslidden or lost or far from God, you don't have to stay that way. God wants to bring us back. Look at verse 7 in your own Bibles there. God wants to bring us back as it was in the first, when we first got saved, when we first were walking with Him, when our love for the Lord and our desire and our passion to serve Him was the greatest. He wants to return us back to that as the first. And that was the great rebuke and revelation of the church at Ephesus that had so many things done right, and the Lord commended them for so many things they had done right. But then He says, thou hast left thy first love. And so God has the power to help us, redemption and second chances. He also has the powerful renewal and forgiveness. Look at verse 8, and we're almost to look at renewal and forgiveness. He says, I will cleanse them from all their iniquity whereby they have sinned against me, and I will pardon all their iniquities whereby they have sinned and whereby they have transgressed against me. He wants to give us renewal and forgiveness. I won't take time to turn there now, but Psalm 51, 1 through 13 is a powerful passage on King David after his sin with Bathsheba. And he cried out to God in his utter brokenness when he had totally blown it. And there was the death of Bathsheba's husband, and there was the death of the child that was born in sin. And he just said, have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness, according to the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgressions. And he goes on to say, against thee, thee only have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight, and so on and so forth. And God gave him a sense of renewal. And God wants to give us a renewal. He doesn't want us to stay. He doesn't want us to stay in that backslidden state. He wants us to repent and get right with God, and to get right with Him and to move forward. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. And one of the best things that we see here that God can do when we call on Him, even in desperate situations, look at verse 9, is a restoration of joy. A restoration of joy. And that shall be a name of joy, a praise, and an honor before all nations of the earth, which shall hear all the good that I do unto them, and they shall fear and tremble for all the goodness and for all the prosperity that I procure unto it. Thus saith the Lord, again there shall be heard of this place, which ye shall say shall be desolate, without man and without beast, even the cities of Judah, and in the streets of Jerusalem that are desolate, without man and without inhabitant, without beast. What will they hear? Verse 11, the voice of joy and the voice of gladness. The voice of joy and the voice of gladness. In fact, I said Psalm 51, 1 through 13, encourage you to read that, a psalm of confession and repentance by David. Part of that, verse 12, David says, restore unto me the joy of thy salvation. He didn't say restore unto me thy salvation. I believe once we're truly saved and born again, the Bible teaches we can't lose that. Now, we could be deceived. We could be thinking that we're saved when we're not. But once we're truly saved and born again, I don't believe that you can be unborn once we're truly saved. And so he said, restore unto me the joy of thy salvation. I don't believe a believer can lose their salvation. If you agree with that, say amen. But we can and we do lose our joy. And that's not an amen, that's an oh my, or an oh me. We do lose our joy. And, the Bible has so much to say about joy. The joy of the Lord is our strength. The Bible talks about joy in when Jesus was announced, his birth, Luke 2:10, behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy. I remember when God confronted Cain after he had killed Abel, God said to Cain, why is thy countenance fallen? In other words, why are you looking so sad, Cain? And of course, there was sin there, but we need to pick it up. I won't say which milestone, but last year about this time, in March, my wife had a milestone birthday. And I put the number of pictures on Facebook that I had of her that matched what her birthday number was. If she wants to tell you what her birthday number was, I'll let her do that. I won't do that for her. But I had somebody comment on Facebook and said, of all those pictures over from the time I first met her 30 years ago until now, she said, I just love it that she's smiling in every picture. And I just tell you this, not one time did I have to say, okay, Michelle, now smile, because she just has that joy about her. And it wasn't sometimes for pictures, I have the cheesiest smile. If you tell me to smile during a picture, it's going to turn out bad. How many have a smile kind of like that? Kind of a cheesy grin. Okay, don't smile, just keep your lips closed. That's what they tell me, the person behind the camera. But my wife has a joy about her, and it shows up in all those photos, and it shows up in life. I'm just saying, church, we can think we're saved and not be. That's a real thing. But for those that are saved, we may not lose our salvation, but we do lose our joy. Here in a couple weeks, 12 days, is it? Yeah, something like that, is Vacation Bible School. I thought I would close this morning with a classic Vacation Bible School song. No one here is too cool. No one here is too old to sing it. But we'll just sing the first stanza. I have the joy, joy, joy down in my heart. How many know that song? Every hand goes up, every hand goes up. The sides are going to be, I have the joy, joy, joy. And the middle is going to be, where? Okay, you can do that middle. I mean, it's big. Middle, if you don't come through, the whole thing just falls flat on its face. But the sides are, I have the joy, joy, joy down in my heart. And you're, where? And then when we get to the chorus, all three sections sing the chorus. Are we ready? This side, you ready? This side, you ready? Where's, are you ready? All right. Here we go, sides. I have the joy, 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 joy down in my heart. Down in my heart. Down in my heart. I have the joy, 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 joy down in my heart. Down in my heart to stay. Now, I know there's more that goes with that. But y'all did a good job. Hey, many of you in here today, I know you have the love of Christ in you and you've been saved. And I know life beats us down sometimes. Life is hard and life can be hard. I totally get it. But God's called us to be joyful. And I think part of the reason why the church in America is anemic and without strength, part of it is because Nehemiah says the joy of the Lord is your strength. And we've lost some of that joy of the Lord. And Jeremiah, God can restore that. If you say, well, I've lost it, I don't even know where to find it. Well, the Bible says in Hebrews, consider him who endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds. Part of it is just getting our eyes off of our circumstances and what's went wrong and who's done us wrong and how we may have done wrong. Getting our eyes off of that and getting our eyes back onto Christ. For consider him who endured such contradiction of sinners against himself. Why? Lest you be wearied and faint in your minds. Let's have everybody stand, every head bow, every eye close. It was a short message this morning, abbreviated message this morning. God may have spoken to someone in picture and worship in the various testimonies that were shared throughout the service. Maybe someone here, obviously you're not in prison today like Jeremiah was, and yet you feel very much in bondage, you feel very much captive, you feel very much shut in like he was. And you've got no place to turn. You feel like you have no right to ask. You know that you know that you know you have no money to pay. And yet God's calling you to call unto him. And I will answer thee and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. If you have some kind of an unspoken prayer or just some great burden of your heart that seems humanly impossible, you have no strength left to fight against this, you've cried all the tears you can, you're at the end of yourself. You're at what the Bible calls, you're at your wit's end. This altar is a good place to come this morning and call unto God. He invites you to do so. You come.
Come every soul by sin oppressed, there's mercy with the Lord. And he will surely give you rest by trusting in his word. Only trust him, only trust him, only trust him now. He will save you, he will save you. He will save you now.